Dow Jacora Clark. I'm 29, raised in Roxbury, live in Dorchester. I'm a UMass Boston student. The community I currently reside in is Dorchester, back and forth from Roxbury to Dorchester. And I am a writer on the PJILC project. I first met Dan and Wusu right here on this campus, Wheelock. We went to Ghana, Cape Verde, and Morocco. The trip abroad was a service learning experience. So we went there to work. Specifically, we went there to teach. We were split in half. Half was there to teach language. The other half was there to teach camera skills. We were also there to learn. We were there to learn about our history as far as ports, as far as where we were dropped off, as far as the experiences of our ancestors being brought from Africa to America. We were also expected to learn about the political scene in these foreign countries, such as Ghana, such as meaning people, such as Cape Verde, again, meaning people. We were expected to keep our decorum and respect at all times. So, all of my challenges pretty much had to do with limitations. I am from Boston, low socioeconomic status. So therefore, you know, across Boston, I've traveled a lot, but never traveled outside the country. That was my first time. Going there took a lot of bravery, a lot of spirit, a lot of heart, a lot of gusto. I came back with all of that and new knowledge of how to maneuver around in society, how to deal with pressure, heavy pressure, and still be positive the whole time through, and still be a good worker. My name is Dow Jacora Clark, and I'm a writer for PJILC.
Alameen Cease. I grew up, born and raised in the Bronx, New York, and I'm a graduate of Wheelock, class of 2014. I was a communications and American studies major at Wheelock College. I met Dan my high school year, my junior year of high school. He was doing a community program with Boston students and New York City students. And I met him through this storytelling program that he was doing through that mentorship program he was doing. And I met his dad, who was he was doing this project on a Nazi, and the story of a Nazi, and how a Nazi, the spider stories, have had an impact worldwide on African culture. For me, I think growing up, living in the projects, just surrounded by like lots of crackheads and like a lot of people who was selling crack, it wasn't very easy to avoid that. Like you get a lot of people who, you see the money all the time, you see how much money everybody's making, and you kind of think about getting involved in some of that stuff. I think I managed to avoid a lot of that, but I got into a lot of fighting as a result of my voicing that it was stupid. And I remember one specific night, me and like I think 10 of my other friends, we went to go to this street that we probably shouldn't have been at, and we just, there was a dude who was really just spouting a lot of nonsense about us, and you know, we went to go like handle that. And I remember for me, what was a turning point was after leaving there, we split up and we get pulled over by three police cars. Each car had two cops in it, and two of them had M4 automatic weapons out. The other two had their pistols out, another two had their hands on their weapons. They told us to line up against the wall, And I think one of my boys is whispering in my ear that he's gonna run. And for me, it was one of the most scariest moments in my personal, in my life, because I spent a lot of time walking the streets at 4 a.m., 5 o'clock in the morning, you know, looking for beef, looking for fights, because I felt like if I did that, nobody would bother me. And I just remember thinking, like, I'm gonna die. Luckily, like, we got past it. They asked for our IDs, they searched us, we were fine. But I think for me, that was my sophomore year of high school. I was pretty much like a D student, and I started to get a little more focused on my work. I didn't stop fighting per se, because at the time I was involved in like gangs. So I still was out on the streets. It was just I would get home, do most of my homework, and when I was in school, like, I was safe. So, Alameen Cease, I am a writer for PJO.
Okay. State your name, the community you come from, and how you're related to this institution.
My name is Bienvenido Estevez. I come from Lawrence, but I was born and raised partly in Dominican Republic, and I am a graduate of Wheelock College. The way I met Dan was actually because of his wife, Susan Owusu, another mentor of mine. She was teaching a media and race class and actually piqued my interest in communications. And I wanted to do a little bit of production as well, so she told me that her husband was definitely the guy to see. Took a couple classes, and I mean, no turning back from there. He's been a great mentor. I've been able to travel out of the country with him because of him, and he's actually one of the people who advocated for me to return to the institution after, you know, things arose. Well, when we went to Ghana, Dan warned me. He said, "You're going to be sitting with powerful people." And at first, I didn't really know what that meant. You know, we were going out there on a mission. And long story short, I went from sitting with, you know, people with maybe no direction to sitting with former presidents and, you know, resistance leaders, legendary soldiers of Cape Verde. And it was just amazing, like, being able to get chosen to sit next to these people and feel that aura. So, on our expedition to Cape Verde in Ghana, I was actually helping teach English, as well as the majority was the communications aspect, which was giving the children of Ghana and Cape Verde cultural competency as it stands in America, basically the way that they're being looked at by the world outside. And we taught them about some of the cartoons that are banned in America because of the racial connotations. And it was really interesting to see how many of these children have never seen the outside perception of African people. And it's important because at the end of the day, if you don't know what you're facing, if you don't know what people think about you, then you're never gonna know why it is that you're being held back, or why, you know, the resources are being taken, why you're not getting any recognition for any of these things. And now I feel like we were actually able to teach them a couple of life skills that they're gonna be able to use to change that status quo. So something that I really learned about the children that I worked with in Ghana and Cape Verde was they're just so smart. Kids that were 10, 11 years old were picking up concepts that we learned in college. How to work a camera, how to, you know, write a script, everything, storyboarding, learning English. They all wanted to go to college. They all wanted to go outside of the country. They all had aspirations. And that's not something that you really see in this country that often for people of color, especially people who are first generation immigrants who may have trouble learning the language or may have trouble assimilating. And I feel that something that they definitely taught me that I could actually speak on behalf of our people here is just learning how to make the best out of your opportunities. These kids had nothing, and now they're gonna, with the equipment that we were able to leave, they're gonna be able to make their own news stories and change the perception of Ghanaian and Cape Verdean people everywhere. So one of the biggest challenges I faced was actually at Wheelock College. I had been vacationing in Dominican Republic for around a month and some change, and I came a few days late to the campus. Came on a Friday. By the following Tuesday, my room had been raided by the Res Life board committee. They found a couple of pounds worth of marijuana under my bed, and from that point I was suspended. They gave us 3 days to, you know, collect ourselves, get ready for a hearing. I had to jump from couch to couch, you know, asking friends, because I couldn't bear the shame of telling my parents. I didn't want them to know until I knew that I could either get out of it or I could be defeated. So, you know, for actually 3 days turned into 2 weeks. 2 weeks of eating once a day, like jumping around. Eventually, we had our hearing, and I went in there and I decided to try to save both of us instead of telling a truth that would bring someone down. And because of that, I actually was suspended for the entire semester. They didn't know if they wanted me back in the school, and I didn't know if I was going to be able to come back until I heard from one of my other mentors, Willie Rodriguez, and he informed me that he had actually advocated on my behalf. Jamie Bosicott also advocated on my behalf when she came back from her maternity leave. And I was able to get a second chance, and I did graduate that following year, not with the three majors that I wanted, but I graduated with two, so that's always great. And I mean, it was definitely a difficult time, but I definitely feel that I learned a really valuable lesson, and that's that at the end of the day, you have to be true to yourself first and foremost. My mother's always said this: the first three people in your life are you, 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 and then everyone else follows. And at that moment in time, it was harder to be about me, and it was harder to own up to the fact that I had to do those things for myself instead of others. And because of that, I did suffer, but I feel that, you know, every experience has a lesson attached to it, and I felt like I actually got one that I'm gonna carry forever. When they pulled me out of the room, they actually threatened to involve law enforcement. It was a sizable amount of marijuana. You know, in Massachusetts, the legal amount is an ounce. Anything more than that and you can get jail time. So 2 or 3 pounds is an overstatement, an over-exaggeration for that situation. And I don't know why they didn't do it. Maybe it was just to save some credibility for the school and not have that involved. But thank my lucky stars that they didn't tell anybody, that they didn't involve the police and only involve the campus security. And because of that, I was actually able to escape the situation in a better position. My name is Bienvenido Estevez, and I'm a writer for Peugeot.
So here I am, your typical middle schooler in Boston, with all this peer pressure and influence to, it was either, how are you gonna provide for your low income family? You know, are you gonna sell drugs? You're gonna join a gang? Are you gonna play basketball? Are you gonna rap? All these influences that people at that time were really trying to figure out. And I had just joined a gang. I remember we were BTG, Beantown Gunners. I was 13 or 14. And we didn't do much but really fight other people in school. But then it started to get serious, because after school, we would hang out in front of the store and look for people to mess with and, you know, smoke and all that stuff. So 2 months into doing that, and I thought that's where I was going to be, a good friend of mine introduced me to the program Youth Voice Collaborative, and I started going there after school, which kind of changed, okay, maybe, you know, this might be my future instead of this. But I wasn't really sure until I started going more and realizing that I don't want to do this gang stuff. And what really put me over the edge is our leader. I remember his name was Terrence, and he came up with the name BTG, Beantown Gunners. He got stabbed 27 times. Head, neck, shoulders, back, stomach, everywhere. Just being in the wrong place at the wrong time. And I remember being at his funeral and seeing him stretched out, you know what I mean? And like, just so pale. And I was like, I don't want this. I can't do this, you know what I mean? This is someone who I was just with in school, after school. Like, I still owed him a quarter for a juice he had bought me. Like, and it was serious. And it was at that time that I was like, nah, I don't want this. I want to go where I've been going after school. And every day after school, that's where I went. That's where I ended up. And through that program, I got to meet John Kerry, which was amazing because I never thought me, coming from where I came from, would be in the position to even meet somebody like John Kerry. I got to work on Deval Patrick's internet campaign.